to thank you all, 10 of you, to be here today. I know there's a lot of different performances and concerts during this exact same time, so I'm very happy to see you all and to share with you the researches I've been doing during the three last years. So my name is Jennifer Lachaine. I'm from Canada. Bonjour Corinne.
Bonjour.
So I'm a saxophonist, as you are, and I'm also I'm studying to be a researcher because I'm doing a PhD in art studies and practices, and I've decided to hi.
Hello.
I was just presenting myself, so it's kind of boring. I'm funny too. so yeah, I decided to work during this PhD on instrument teaching and especially on the way we can improve it. So I studied the evolution of saxophone teaching since the beginning, or kind of, and I tried to find some kind of patterns in it, how we were teaching it in all countries, but I haven't been in every country to ask people, but I've read a lot on it. And I'm trying to find a new model, if it's possible, but I'm not going to give you a solution to every problem today. I'm not done with the PhD first, and then I don't think I'm the only one who can change what's problematic now. So I'm just going to share with you the researches I've done, especially in the last year, in the last 3 years. And I'm going to share with you my thoughts and my opinions on this topic. So if you have any question, and if I'm not clear because of the accent, maybe you can just raise your hand and we'll stop, because I have an hour and I don't think I'm going to take an hour. So you can interrupt me and ask me to be clear if it's not. Yeah, so I'm going to talk about auditory register impasse as a compositional technique of saxophone teaching. I'm going to talk especially about saxophone teaching from experimental music point of view. Which means I analyzed a lot of parts for saxophone, so a lot of pieces from our repertoire, and I realized the usage of this register is very interesting because it changed a lot in the past few decades, and we can see that these changes have an impact on the way we're playing saxophone and probably on the way we should teach it. So here's the agenda for today. I feel like a teacher saying that, but I'm not. So, well, I'll just do a little overview to explain why I'm talking about this, and then I'm going to enter the real subject, talking about the altissimo register, which is a very old technique, well, for our instrument, but has been used in a new way since the last few years, in the last few decades. And then I'm going to talk about altissimo register in new music, in experimental music, but in three specific contexts, three specific pieces, which are the Albrecht Sonata, Armure Verdoyant from Philippe Leroux. It's a duet for soprano saxophone and voice. It's very nice if you don't know it. I love it. And then I'm going to talk about XVIII for soprano saxophone and orchestra, who has been written by Philippe Bellon, who's right there. So if you have any question on the piece, maybe you can ask him at the end. Well, talking about these three specific contexts, I will show you the evolution of the functions composers attributed to the altissimo register, and I will show you how it affects the saxophone playing and the saxophone teaching to be able to leads to maybe a new model of saxophone teaching we could try. And this new model is based on two possible lines of approach, which is clear understanding through abstraction and body integration. So there's a mental axis and also a physical axis. Any question? No. Okay, so first we can see, we can notice that experimental music, it's okay. And new music are taking a lot of importance in our repertoire right now. So it's been long at the beginning of, when the instrument was invented, to have composer, sorry, I'm looking for my word in English, to, well, if, you know, it's been long for the composer to write for us. We had to wait, and then they started to write music for us, for a saxophonist. And finally, I think we're at a moment where composers are writing a lot for saxophonists, but they're changing the way that we see saxophone, they're changing the way the ancient technique were used. So it leads to some kind of mutation of the composition, musical exploration, and interpretation relating to classical or contemporary saxophone. So it means we need to be aware of the impact of this mutation on saxophone teaching. It also means maybe we should think about a renewed model, renewed teaching based on inherent compositional technique in new music. So let's talk about altissimo register. So it's a very big assessment to say that it may be considered as being the origin of the contemporary techniques. I just wanted to mean that it's one of the first extended techniques that composer used at the start, one of the first. So we saw it in 1926 first when Bumke analyzes the fundamental notes and started to talk about high pitch notes. And then Schoenberg used it for tenor and bass part in some orchestra work in 1930, which is not a century after the invention of the instrument. And then, well, as you probably already know, Stephen Rasher officially develops the high pitch notes technique based on natural harmonics. And starting to, well, his development of the technique, the composers dedicate to a lot of saxophone works for him. And when it started, they wanted to use this kind of register to, well, extend the register for sure. And it was also to show the interpret's virtuosity or to show a specific brightness of a section of the work. So they were using altissimo register to make a section brighter or, well, I don't have any word in English now, but brighter with more éclat.
Mm-hmm.
More shiny.
Sparkles.
Extinction. And they were also using it to show how the interpret is good. It's great, actually. So you can think about Concertino da Camera from Ibert. When the altissimo register is used, it's always after a lot of notes who are going to the this kind of register. So it's not without preparation. It's like we're going to go higher and higher and higher and then the altissimo register. And it's also when the tension is rising and damn altissimo register. So it's always with loud dynamics, complex rhythms, fast beats, and contexts where the tension is rising at this time. So this idea of virtuosity and brightness remained kind of topical for a long time in the neoclassical literature as well as in the contemporary literature. So I've just written some examples. I don't know if you know these pieces, but we can see that the altissimo register is also used to show virtuosity or brightness in Kotikan from Pietzuet, especially because it has been written from the competition in Dina for the sonata, Muzhinsky sonata, and also for in the Freiburg sonata. We can see this kind of appearance of the altissimo register when it's very loud dynamics and very fast beats and also complex rhythms. But we can also see some kind of modifications in the use of the altissimo register as compositional technique. So we can see now that, not in this example, but in the one I'm going to present after, that the altissimo register is now used more in lyrical context or in very different contexts. And it's more to serve the piece than to serve the interpret. So I'll start the talk about the Albert Sonata. But first, you probably know it's a piece that was commissioned by three different groups financed by the National Endowment for the Arts. And it has four different movements, very contrasted. So there's two-part invention, La Folia Nuova, element for George Pacioppo, because George died during the writing of the piece. And third movement, Scherzo, well, you can read that. So the second movement is the most expressive and also show where there is a single register, and to show you some, well, what I thought was important. So first, the two first high pitch notes that appear in the piece here are in a very different context. So it's kind of a cadenza context at lib, and we have to play it piano towards mezzo piano with poco lirico. So it has to be very lyrical, and these two notes actually add some lyricism to the passage. So they are not there to serve the virtuosity of the interpret or to show some brightness, some sparkles, as Michel was saying. They're there to add some lyricism. So it's a very big change, because it wasn't like this for a very long time when the composers were using a single register. And then we can also notice, looking to all the movements, that the second movement and the recitative part of the last movement are the one with the most appearance of the altissimo register, which shows that the composer decided to put the altissimo register in the more lyrical movements. So it means something. It means he decided to don't put it in movement with loud dynamics and fast beats and complex rhythms. We can also see that in the first movement, it was very fast and more complex than the others, that the high pitch note, the altissimo register, is always used in the part called cadenza or ad lib context. And it's always part that are lenter, not slower. I invented a new word just for you. So there's no high pitch note in the first movement when it's very fast. It's always when it's slower, rubato, well, cadenza, and more lyrical, actually. And in the third movement, there's also for sure some high pitch notes, but it starts very pianissimo the first time it appears. Sorry if I it starts with some kind of association that is present throughout the whole movement. And well, yeah, the first time we saw it, it's very, very soft, which is different from using it when it's loud. And also, it is reiterated at the end of the movement, starting forte, but it suddenly starts to do a decrescendo. We use that in English too, I guess. Decrescendo. Yeah, okay, thanks. And it's going to quasi niente, which is very difficult when you play out, well, more difficult when you play out some register. And it's new kind of register. But we can also see some presence of the altissimo register associated with loud dynamics, fast beats, and complex rhythms, especially at the end of the last movements with a lot of arpeggios. So there's still, in this sonata, this kind of idea that altissimo register has to be associated with virtuosity and brightness, but it's only at the end, and it's not as present and as meaningful than all the other use Albright's did for the altissimo register. Then, if you should keep in mind some things about what I just said, it should be that the altissimo register is first used by Albright as lyricism, softness, and expression allies. So it's kind of expressive markers. And the altissimo register usually appears in expressive sections and must be played and sung in delicate manner. But we can also see that some passages of the sonata are marked by the idea of virtuosity and power. So now, in the Philip Lowe's duet, we can see a very drastic and innovative change about the use of the altissimo register. But first, let's talk about the overview of the piece. So Philippe Lovu, as you probably say, is a French composer, was played at the opening concert. Claude Delon, you were there, I guess. Claude Delon played the piece. And I don't know if you noticed, maybe not, but the use of the altissimo register was exactly like this. The altissimo register that appears in this piece wasn't to show the interpreter virtuosity, even if it is, but it was to serve the piece. It was very different from what you see in Concertino La Camera. I was paying attention because, well, I knew I would talk about it. Well, so, yeah, He was influenced a lot by the spectral music and his key composers as Gérard Bizet and Tristan Murail. And as he himself said, the idea of perpetual movement and continuity, especially in the sound and the gestures, is present in most of his works. So Un lieu verdoyant is a musical tribute to Gérard Bizet. So he wrote it, it's a musical tribute to it. And it's a text written by Philippe Lebeau, but according to Lamentation du Prophète Jérémie, another text. So the piece is divided, well, can be divided into 8 sections. It depends who analyzes the piece. And we can see this idea of perpetual movement and continuity through all the work, all the piece, especially during the transitions. And it's very important that the voice and the saxophone show some unity, because they're almost one at certain points during the piece. So for me, this piece shows, as I was saying, a very drastic and innovative change in the use of the altissimo register, because first, it has only one note, one high-pitched note, and it appears during a transition going to the most dramatic section of the piece. So it's a very high sinatrial, as you probably can see here, or I can also I'll go the other side. Can I take a few seconds? Oh, sorry. So there's only one note. You're doing all the piece, one high pitch note, sorry. And it starts pianissimo, so very soft with no preparation. It's suddenly attacked, and it's more than two octaves higher than the last notes the saxophonist was playing before. So it's not like a lot of notes going higher, 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 and higher, and bam, the altissimo register. It's like we're playing something, and then it's something totally new who announces what's going to happen after. Especially because then it's going crescendo until fortissimo, and it's asked to finish with en lâchant les lèvres, comme un cri violent et déchirant. So it means you have to drop the jaw, and it's going to sound, you have to make it sound like it was a violent and heartbreaking shout, kind of. So it announces what the singer is going to sing right after On me fait violence. I'm going to have to translate this one. We're doing violence to me. We're trying to say she's kind of a victim of violence right after the saxophonist played something very violent. So these high pitch notes have been chosen to as a transition marker, but also as a very important expression marker. So, well, things to remember, I just said it. It's very innovative that you use only one high pitch note in the entire piece to as a transition. And it's also, this note is also a very strong highlight of expression. And we can see that this high pitch notes announce what the voice will sing, so it reinforces the link between the voice and the saxophone that is very important in this piece. Now, let's talk about XVIII from Philippe Bellin. It is very funny to talk about a piece when the composer is right there, so I hope I won't make mistakes. So Philippe Bellin is a Canadian composer whose works and music composition focus on pre-analytical concept. Am I right? Great. So XVIII is actually a concerto for saxophone soprano, and it's in a series of episodes. So the soprano saxophone appears in the fourth episode, but it's just like a teaser. And then the XVIII is concentrated on the saxophone soprano. So it's the story of the saxophone soprano. So this series of episodes introduce recurring characters, and the characters are the instruments. And there's a common frame, I think, during all the episodes. So the soprano saxophone is the main character of episode 8. And well, we have to notice that even if he is the main character, he can take two different roles. He can be a narrator and talk about his own story, or he can play in his own story and be an actor. So its interventions may relate to one or the other of both roles. I can also show you a part. I played it recently, so it's almost ready if you want to play it. Okay, so the use of the Altissimo register is in link with Filippo, who did before. So he used it in a very different way, and he used it, Filippo Long, used the Altissimo register as a, well, to mark the when the saxophone is changing roles. So each time the Altissimo register is present is when the saxophone, the final saxophone is the narrator. So it's always where there's no orchestra and it has to be played very, I don't know if you can see, it's very slow. It's no pointing.
Dotted
quarter. 26. And it has to be, it's written très expressive, so very expressive. And mélangé avec l'air, which means mixed with air, the sound. So it has to sound very uncontrolled, but if you want to play it right, you have to control it a lot, actually. So yeah, each time you have a high pitch note, it's always when the saxophone is the narrator. So it's there to see that the character of saxophone soprano has changed his role. So he's not anymore a player or an actor, he's now a narrator. So in this piece, what's very interesting and what's showed the evolution of the use of the Altissimo register in new music is that the Altissimo register has been used as an expressive marker, but especially to indicate a change in the role of the character played by the saxophone. So, yeah, I've already said that. Okay, so maybe if I want to summarize everything I've said since the beginning, we can see that the Altissimo register appeared in the word works for saxophone about 80 years after the invention of the instrument, which shows a lot of audacity and creativity for from the artisan of the world of classical saxophone, because it was not even a century before we started using extended technique. So although this register is officially used as compositional technique since a few decades, and even it has been only a few decades, it has evolved a lot. So because of this very big evolution, I think we have to keep in mind that it has an impact, it affects a lot the way we're playing saxophone. So we have to think about the next generation and maybe start changing the way we're teaching to them, if you teach. So the change in the functions of the Altissimo register as compositional techniques requires further reflection in the saxophone teaching. It's not good enough to only produce the Altissimo register. We have to be able to control every kind of parameters related to the sound, to this kind of sound. So we have to be able to play Altissimo register with every dynamics you can have in mind, every kind of timbre, every type of sound, and also every character, because it can be used in so many different ways, as you saw, I guess, in these examples. Because I'm interested in saxophone teaching, I was thinking maybe we can start to think about a renewed model in saxophone teaching, a new way of conceiving it. And I was thinking maybe it's better if we do that, having in mind two different axes. So one of these axes is the importance of making the students understand fully everything he's doing and being able to explain it himself or herself, and also the importance of integrating in our body what we're doing. So we have to develop some mental condition to be able to play right, and also some physical condition. I'm not sure I'm using the right words now, but I don't, you'll just correct me. Okay, so if you want to develop a new model of saxophone teaching using a complete understanding by abstraction, I'll just explain this. According to what I read before, and probably what you experienced with your teacher, or maybe not, you tell me after in the questions and commentary section. I realized that often when saxophone teachers teacher are teaching, they make the students repeat a lot what they're doing, their sound, their gestures. So they're trying to put some kind of procedural knowledge, which is just a knowledge of, it's gestures actually, when you say procedural knowledge. So they're trying to put this, like, in the students without always explaining everything right before. So it's kind of, they were transposing directly their knowledge in the students without prior assimilation and adaptation. It's just the way it has been done before. It's not because they wanted to do it bad, for sure. But according to Terrien and Bellegroux, the task of the teacher, the musician as a teacher, is to be able to pass himself or herself to his procedural knowledge, to his way to playing thing and doing things very greatly, to declarative knowledge, so to being able to explain it in words and putting everything he's doing in words. And then asking to the students to explain in words what he's going to have to play, and after making him play. So given the complexity of the techniques and high-level skills that are now required, it is crucial to make our students understand everything very completely. Mere execution is not enough, so only play something is not enough. We have to understand completely the context around it, so the piece or the technical exercises. And we also have to understand completely what we're doing, so being able to say every steps of the learning process. So I'm starting with air, and there it's going to my throat, so what's my throat doing right now, and then it's going to my mouth, oh, my tongue, okay, it has to be placed this way, and being able to explain it, not just repeat it. So, for example, the learning saxophonist who's learning autism register or how to play autism register should be able to explain the complete sequence of gestures used to produce high pitch notes, but also the technique or expressive effect desired in the piece where the autism register is used. So if you want to ensure this complete understanding, we have to start using exercises that foster affection and generalization. Very hard word to say in English. So according to Barth, not in the Simpsons, concept is acquired when the learner can generalize from non-examples. It means, with the example of autism register, if we want it to be fully acquired, it's going to be So a technique as autism register will be fully completed only when the students or the player will be able to do it in every kind of context, starting with the techniques he has learned before. So he has to be able to play it with every kind of dynamics, what I was saying before, every kind of timbres, type of sounds, etc. Well, it's very important to have a big theoretical idea of what we're playing, but it's also important to feel it, so to have it in our body. Because the quality of the sound relies on the accompanying sequence of gestures. It means that if there's a failure in the way you're playing, it's probably gonna be a failure in what you're playing. So in your autism register, for example. Yeah, so we have to use appropriate gestures and to make it integrate our full body if you want to be able to have the quality of sound desired. And we can make the students be very conscious of the movement they're doing by using movement in our teaching. Using movement in our teaching just means we should maybe use gestures and sounds that are similar to the gesture and sounds we're producing when we're playing. So, for example, if we're trying to play or explain the autism register, and we're working especially on the way the thumb should be placed, maybe we can use some syllables that are similar to the that are using the same position of the tongue. So I don't know, maybe if you're using the sound k or something like that, it's going to be very similar to what you're doing when you're playing the autism register. But yeah, so it's going to make the technique everybody easily. Okay, so I'm gonna finish giving you some tools, but maybe it's very maybe you already know everything of this and I just put it in a nice way, or maybe you're gonna learn some things. So I think sometimes we enter, because I teach a lot, so maybe sometimes we, as a teacher, we enter a room and we're just like, okay, I'm gonna let the student play and I'm gonna correct everything he's doing wrong. And we didn't plan our lessons before, but I think it's very important to plan our lessons, but also, well, listen to him when he's playing and adapt for sure. But to have in mind how we should explain these different techniques to be ready when it's gonna come. So if I wanna plan how I would teach the alto, the technique to play alto register, I think first I would identify the sequence of basic gestures required to produce the high pitch register, because I do it, but it's important I know how I do it first. Where does it start and where does it go after and how does it finish? And then when you identify the complete sequence, you can divide the sequence into its main components and clarify every aspect. It means, okay, start with air pressure. Okay, what do I have to do with air pressure? Does it have to be a very intense air pressure or not so many air? And then it goes to my throat. Should I open it, close it, or what happens? Do the vocal cords are used in this process? And then it arrives to my mouth. Should I change the way I place my tongue? Should I move my jaw? Should I move my lips or not? So you have to think, I think, about every of these aspects to be able to explain it after. And then for sure, for each of the aspects, identify the more relevant theoretical elements to be explained. So just go to the point. When it's time to teach, I think it's better if you explain the whole sequence of the gestures you're gonna have to use to play the altissimo register first. So if you're gonna give a goal to the students. We're gonna go there sometime. And then request the learner to play the exercises related to each of the components of the sequence. So exercises only for the air pressure, and then only for the throat, and then only for the vocal cords if it's necessary, and only for the mouth and the tongue. And purposely add and link these exercises. So link exercises about air pressure to play altissimo register and about throat together. And at the end, request the learner to play exercises involving the complete sequence of gestures. So making him able to play the altissimo register, not only a part of it. So if you want to be sure you're making your student acquire complete understanding and a complete control of the technique, maybe you can use the steps. So while the learner is practicing each component of the gestural sequence, bring him or her to repeat the theoretical elements related to the sequence and each gesture of the sequence. And not only the words you were using, but he or her has to be able to say it in his, her, or, well, it, his own words, sorry. So at the point where the learner should play the complete sequence, you have to ask him to repeat every gesture in the sequence and every theoretical aspects in link with the sequence and the gestures. And after that, when he can play everything, change some parameters in asking to play it very fast or very loud or trying to imitate voice, or change the way you ask him, how you ask him to play it, and make him able to be conscient of what parameters he has to change to make this change at the end. And when he's ready to play altissimo register in a specific piece, make sure he or she is able to understand the context around it. So if you play altissimo register in Ibar, it's not going to be the same thing than when you play it in Le Roux. You have to change the way you're thinking and conceiving the altissimo register, and the student has to be conscious of this. So if you want to now allow body integration, as I was saying before, it's very important to use some kind of gestures and sounds that are similar to the one you're using to produce the technique of the altissimo register or any kind of technique you're trying to teach. To make him be conscious of what kind of gestures he has to do and integrate it in his or her body, but without doing exactly the technique. And it's very important to keep in mind that movement and musical direction must be the ultimate objective, even when we're teaching technical exercises. So, yeah, finally, conclusion. So he said that new music has taken a very big importance in the saxophone repertoire, and it has impacts of the way we're playing saxophone, the way we're conceiving saxophone, and also I think the way we're teaching saxophone. So in order to develop saxophonists who will easily adapt to the mutation we're looking for the new music, it is important to think and reconsider the dominant saxophone teaching model. And I think we should do that pre-revising or with two. The complete understanding by abstraction and also the body integration. So yeah, that was it. Here's BB Yoga Nafi, so I've got like 3 or 4 pages, so if you wanna see everything, maybe you can just ask me and for your references. Do you have any questions? I talk very fast.
Will this be somewhere available for everybody, like on the website?
Okay, well, I published at the end of the PhD, and I'm working on an article, but I'm not sure it's going to be published in 2018, so maybe it's going to be in 2019, and it's avec la FAMEC.
Right.
So it's an association for the teachers in Quebec, Canada, but I think you can find it very easily on the web, or you can maybe take my email at the end, and I'll send it to everyone who's interested by the subject. And yeah, I'll do this exact, but maybe improved lecture in French in 2 different places in Canada in 2019, but we won't be there, I guess, if you're not from Canada. Okay, so do you have any? Yeah.
I was curious if you have done any research in that when the saxophone was invented, out of sax had thought of it as a performing instrument in 4 octaves. And it is said that he performed in what would be called an altissimo register. That when he invented the instrument himself,
yeah,
he performed music on it, not originally written, in 4 octaves.
I've read that, but what I've read, it said it wasn't sure it did for real.
Oh.
So I'm not, I don't know if it's real, so I'm not using it in a lecture.
There's not enough to support it.
Yes, you have to, or if you want to talk about it, you have to be sure what you're saying. It's real. So maybe I've read it, but I'm not sure, so I'm not using it, but thanks.
Little question, maybe. I've heard that the altissimo register was regarded as faking, as not serious notes. Maybe do you know when it changed from faking and accidents to serious fingerings?
Yeah. Well, it's not a when, it's more a where. Because when it started with Sigurd Fascher, it wasn't fake, and no one thought it was a fake. I think it's more of a kind of another school. They thought it wasn't important enough, and he was just showing off and actually not playing real notes. So it's not about a timeline, more about where were you going.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I read. But I don't know everything. So if you disagree with everything I said, or just something I said, you can also say it. It's perfect, but I want to confront my idea.
I started thinking about something and used the concertina to come as an example. Because here's Sigurd actually, or maybe in other editions, there are more altissimo parts than others.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the second movement,
yeah,
where there is a phrase going way up in the altissimo register, it's a very expressive highlight of the piece.
It is expressive, I agree, but
yeah,
it's also a bit very loud dynamics. It's very innovative, it's when it's used with soft dynamics, not only in an expressive context, I think. Yeah, it is a good example to show that it wasn't only for show the interpret's virtuosity, but I think the real change happens when
Yeah, it's it's great.
Maybe one little more question to the Ivrea concerto. There is, I don't know if the second or third movement, not in the first movement, obviously, but the second one, I think it's B, E, G, something, something, something. do you think, or what is your idea? Because I heard somebody likes to perform it in the Altissimo register with piano, and somebody not, and somebody with the orchestra, he prefers to play in the normal octave.
Well, it's very personal. I don't think it's, well, I didn't do research on the subject, so it's going to be a very personal answer. I prefer when it's not played in the Altissimo register, because I think it didn't add some lyricism to the passage. It's just gonna show off how the interpret is good. And I think using techniques to show our player is great, well, for me, I don't know, it's not, I don't like it. I prefer if it's there for a reason. I prefer if it's there to serve the piece, actually, or to serve what the composer wanted to say or express, actually. So in this specific passage, I get the impression that it's only to show our signature is good with the Altissimo register, or how the player decided to play it higher is good, but it's very personal. So don't say it outside. Yeah.
Actually, it was for virtuosity purpose.
Yeah.
Specifically. So the composer didn't hear that phrase at that higher pitch. He heard it lower. But Sigur Lachaine wanted to show his virtuosity, so he asked the composer to add it this way. For somebody who was able to do it melodically, I think it works, but it was not the first intention of the composer.
And if I remember well, the Ibar doesn't add some kind of indication, like play it very lyrical, above of the Altissimo register. So he doesn't use it for a specific reason in link with lyricism. So yeah, I think it's better if you play it lower, but if you want to play it higher, it's your choice. Yeah.
Do you think the modern usage of the Altissimo register is, I wouldn't say better, but a more natural approach to the different quality of the instrument than the older side, where you use it very intensely, as it is, like, I think of it as a very intense color of the instrument, because it requires fast air, and it's physically demanding, so it's natural to think of it as an intense quality of the instrument.
I wouldn't say more natural, because it needs a lot of work, and as I was saying, a new way of conceiving the way you're playing saxophone and the way you're teaching. So I wouldn't say it's natural, truly. It's not for me, and it's not for my student. If you play it very naturally, I'm so impressed. But I would say it's for sure more interesting, and it can, it expands a lot the possibilities of our instrument. So it might us able to use the instrument in so many different ways that I would use before. So, I don't know, the composer just showed us a new way with this. I think we should just listen to them and go where they want us to go with this technique, actually. I was thinking, maybe I shouldn't say this. I was thinking after the opening concert, I don't know what you thought about it, but I liked a lot the piece from Lahu, because, well, I like his work in general. And I like it especially because the Altissimo register was used, and every other technique was used for such a purpose each time. And I didn't see the music, the parts, but as I was hearing it, I was like, everything has a reason to be, everything is so magical, it's so. Yeah, I'm getting excited. I was very impressed by how DeLong played it, for sure, but by the piece itself. And the other concerto are great, for sure, and the play- awesome. But every time they were playing alto register, it was always like, so a lot of high notes and then the alto register and show how the player is great. So for me, the reason I'm using the alto register wasn't, I don't know, wasn't so specific and wasn't making us
right
better.
Papers.
Yeah, thanks.
Right,
I'm gonna hire you, Sheldon, for my English lectures. But don't repeat it.
I don't want to be alone and burn him mad at me.
Any other questions? And you can also ask your questions here if you're shy or ask my email.